For the last few months, I've been compiling a list of my favorite 3D printing tricks, hacks, and tips, compiled over years of 3D printing experience. From silly little things I do that save me a second here or there, to clever strategies for overcoming some of 3D printing's most annoying hurdles, here they are. Let's get after it. Have you ever had a roll of filament that you want to print with, but it's waterlogged and in dire need of dehydration? Sure, you could put it in a normal filament dryer and wait 4 to 8 hours. Huh. Or you could spend $1,800 on a DryWise inline filament dryer, which will then thoroughly dry the filament as you print. But unless you're running a business, that's probably not an economically viable option. Instead, allow me to share a surprising trick that I actually discovered thanks to Igor of MyTechFun. Microwave it. Seriously, I know what you're thinking, but as I discovered in my filament recycling journey, it actually works unbelievably well, better than most filament dryers on the market, honestly, and it's fast. Now, personally, I recommend cycles of 30 to 45 seconds on high, after which you check both the inside and the outside temperature of the spool, followed by a 2 to 5 minute cooldown period between drying cycles. But before you burn your house down, a few important things that you do need to know. Number one, I'm not responsible for any injury or property damage as a result of you watching any of my videos. Number two, do not try this with carbon fiber filaments as they will arc, they'll catch fire, and they will cause a disaster. Number three, if your filament has an RFID tag, you need to remove that tag first for the exact same reason. Some modern microwaves, like my combination oven microwave at home, actually do tolerate large metal objects, but even those sometimes arc due to the size and geometry of the RFID tag, so just be careful. Number four, carefully monitor the filament while drying and keep your hand on the cancel button. Regularly check the inside of the filament spool, especially if you're using cardboard spools, because those soak up a lot of moisture and they can then give your filament an unwanted steam bath, resulting in the inner layers fusing together. If you wait till the outside of the filament visibly melts, it is already too late and you've ruined the entire spool. And number five, you probably shouldn't be doing this in the microwave that you use for food, but since I know you're going to do it anyways, I certainly do, you probably should stick to the non-toxic plastics like PLA and PETG, no styrenes. But since I also know that some of you are still going to try drying ABS and nylon, at least clean the microwave after and leave it open to ventilate itself. Hopefully, we're not actually melting the plastic itself, just vaporizing the water molecules inside, so fumes and VOCs should be limited, but I'm definitely not a health expert or a scientist, and none of that stuff can be good for you. Here's another one for the impatient among us. A lot of times in 3D printing or just in making in general, we need to glue something. Unfortunately, with a few exceptions, it seems to me like there's often an inverse relationship between curing time and strength. The fastest drying glues, like hot glue, for example, are extremely weak, and the strongest ones, like masonry glue or rubber cement, take quite a while to fully cure. That's why I use what I like to call the double glue trick. It's pretty simple, really. I apply my stronger glue, and then I leave a little bit of room inside for weaker, more temporary glue to hold things in place while the former cures. This can be hot glue or CA glue with an activator, or even double-sided tape. Now, this technique provides a number of benefits over clamping. First of all, it allows you to continue the assembly of the rest of the project without clamps interfering. It also works really well for oddly shaped objects that would be very difficult to clamp correctly. It doesn't run the risk of shifting later on since your fast glue holds it in place immediately, unlike some clamps. And furthermore, you don't run the risk of damaging or scratching the part like you would with some types of clamps. And finally, it allows you to just forget about it rather than having to come back later and take off the clamps. So enjoy. Okay, hold up, because we do need to take just a quick moment to thank this video's sponsor, which is Sovel, makers of the SV08, SV08 Max, SV0, and an entire line of fantastic budget printers. I've been a huge fan of Sovel and their printers for years because their printers are some of the best value on the market while still staying true to the ideals of open source software and hardware, which is really rare nowadays. Nearly all of their 3D printer designs are fully open source, both software and hardware, allowing you to upgrade them to tweak, tinker, or use them as a basis for your own projects. I, for example, am using a Sovel SV08 as the basis for my ultimate 7-tool changer project, which hopefully I'll be finishing very soon. And I also have really fallen in love with the SV0 as my home desktop printer, just because of its super fast, high-quality printing. So to check out Sovel and support the sponsors that make these videos possible, visit the link in the description or scan the QR code appearing on screen now. Thanks again to Sovel, and let's get back to the video. As some of you may know, I print a ton of DIY recycled filament, which means that I get more clogs in my nozzles than probably anyone else on Earth. Sure, sometimes an acupuncture needle or shoving a hot poker down your extruder will do the job, but sometimes it won't, especially with the rising popularity of CHT and high-flow nozzles, which due to their internal geometry can get some truly biblical clogs. And so, while it's already a pretty well-known tactic, for those of you who don't already know or could use a brush-up, I feel like I am very qualified to teach you the art of the cold pull. Step 1. Clog your nozzle. Check. Step 2. Heat the extruder up to the max temperature or nearby it, and try to purge. Many clogs can be resolved by heat, but even if yours cannot, it will help the material flow around the clog. Step 3. Allow the nozzle to cool to somewhere between 90 and 100 degrees Celsius. I'll teach you a tip in just 1 second for speeding this process up. Step 4. Pull like your life depends on it. Okay. Maybe not that hard. You can pull using the extruder or your hand or both, but do make sure that you're not putting excessive force on your gantry and release the gears if needed. Also, pull slowly. For particularly stubborn clogs like with these increasingly popular integrated heat break designs, I often prefer to actually take the nozzle out and hold it with a pair of pliers just to avoid damaging the gantry or punching the top of the printer when it releases. Again, pull slowly. If you do this successfully, you will see not only the end geometry of your nozzle, which is an indication that the filament didn't break off in the process, but also, hopefully, the clog will be right there for you to observe. I mean, have a look at these beauties. I told you guys, I get a lot of clogs. If you're not successful and the filament does break, there are actually some specialized cleaning filaments out there from companies like eSun or 3D Fuel, which are apparently designed to make cold pulls more successful. Additionally, I sometimes like to kind of combine this technique with the traditional acupuncture needle, basically heating up and melting the filament in the nozzle, and then using the needle to try and dislodge the clog from the tip of the nozzle and push it deeper into the molten plastic, which will then hopefully solidify around it and pull the clog out. So one time may not be effective, but try it a couple of times if you're not successful. Now that we know the cold pull trick, let's talk for just a second about heat. 3D printing involves lots of heat. Heat on the nozzle, heat on the build plate, heat from your significant other when they discover just how much you spend on 3D printing. But a lot of times, we then need to get rid of that heat. Say, for example, you just tried to load your printer at 250C and discovered a clog, so you want to do a cold pull at 90C. Or you loaded filament, but now the nozzle will need to cool down before it can safely probe the bed. Or perhaps an even more frequent example, your print just finished and you want to let the build plate cool so that you can remove the parts without them warping, bending, or damaging the build plate. So what do you do? Wait a few minutes like a grown adult with a functioning sense of impulse control? Instead, I have a clever little hack that I call the conduction cooldown trick. Basically, I take a metal object, for example, my stainless steel shelves in the case of a build plate, or a nozzle wrench in the case of a nozzle, and I press it up against the hot object. Because of science stuff, this transfers the heat away from our hot object faster, saving us a minute or two, so we can get back to printing. All right, this is a silly little one, but it is something that not everyone knows. Unlike toilet paper rolls, which should only ever be oriented in this fashion unless you're a sociopath who wants to watch the world burn, there is no one correct orientation for filament spools. In some cases, a spool should be oriented thusly, whereas in others, thusly. Sometimes it doesn't even matter. Now, it really depends on how the printer is pulling the filament, where you anticipate friction along the path, and sometimes even the weight of the spool, but more on that in just a second. In any case, I personally recommend experimenting with this in each of the different places that you place your filament, i.e. in each of your various different dryers, to really see which way works best. And don't forget to actually pull some filament through the Bowden tube and see how it goes. I've had plenty of prints fail because the Bowden tube creeped up and went around the roll, and somehow that jammed the filament due to friction. A second ago, I mentioned that the weight of a spool can influence the orientation and how it rolls. A lightweight, nearly empty spool can get picked up or knocked over, resulting in a mess or a failed print. Now, this is especially true on some older AMS systems which do not have a spring-loaded depressor to keep the spools in place. But it also can be a big problem if you're printing from a separate spool holder or even a rep rack. Fortunately, I learned the following really cool trick from Courtney over at Filament Stories. She actually recommended picking up some big, heavy steel balls, giggity, to place inside your spools. This works great, but those steel balls definitely aren't cheap, so I've actually found another way to do this, which doubles as a means of keeping your more expensive filaments dry when they're bagged or in the dry box. Simply print these in-spool desiccant containers, fill them up with desiccant or screws or anything really, and place them in the middles of your spools. You also, if you want, could get this very high-end, super effective desiccant that slice engineering cells in a similarly sized container for the same purpose. Either way, no more spool seizures to worry about.
Hold up. As we were editing this video, I actually found another one, though full disclosure, I haven't yet been able to fully try it out myself because I'm still waiting on some of the parts. But I'm really excited to try it out, and I just had to share it with all of you guys. So, you know how 3D printers are getting a lot bigger lately? Well, in most of these bigger machines, that means longer Bowden tubes. And while the latest printers, like the Sovol SV08 Max from this video's sponsor, have built-in filament buffer feeder thingies, a lot of them don't. And that's where this little tool slash hack is super useful. It's a handheld, battery-powered filament feeder that pushes your filament through a tube. You just pinch the filament and the pinching action actually activates the motor, which loads the filament and saves you tons of time, especially if you're loading a tool changer with numerous filaments. Now, I gotta be honest, I actually had this idea myself a while back while talking to a guest on a podcast, but I don't have the CAD skills to actually execute on it. And actually, I'm considering doing a 30-day CAD challenge for just that reason, where I take you guys along on a journey of trying to become a better designer and share what I learned and how I do it. But I'm currently trying to convince the folks over at Onshape that this would be a great video that you guys would love to watch. So drop a comment below to let them know if I'm right or not, and hopefully we can do that video. Oh, and by the way, last call on this t-shirt design and the other one that we released at the same time. We're going to be sunsetting both of these designs at the end of August to make way for some exciting new designs. So if you want one of these, now's your last chance.
Okay, one last one, and this is definitely a very, very silly, very stupid one that will really only save you milliseconds, but it also saves you having to think, which I find just makes the workflow a little easier. Whenever I need to preheat a printer which doesn't have an automatic load or unload macro, I personally like to just tap 222 instead of trying to find 230 or 250 or whatever my fat fingers will land on. I know it's dumb, but I like it. Speeds up my workflow just that little bit. But hey, I'd love to know, what are your silly little tips and tricks for making your 3D printing workflow more enjoyable? I welcome you to comment down below or join our Discord server where we share exactly this type of stuff all the time. And hey, if you like this video, you're definitely gonna like this one where I talk about the secret slicer settings to speed up and improve your 3D prints. And make sure you're subscribed because I'm actually working on a follow-up to that video with some of the newer, lesser known slicing tips that most people still don't even know about. That's all for this week, but I'll see all of you on the next layer.